Today's session we will discuss about parallel databases in detail. So far we were discussing about the basic database architectures that are very popular, and now we need to study in detail about both parallel databases and distributed databases. So we will discuss about parallel database now. So in this particular slide we'll be discussing about the basic introduction about parallel databases. Then we will see some of the parallelism mechanism that can be used while we are accessing the data using IO devices. So that means IO parallelism we will discuss in detail. So as you all know, parallel machines are a common factor that we are actually listening nowadays, because every machine, every computer system, we are adding parallelism into that so that we can add more features into the existing processes where we can execute various operations like database operations also. So the reason for the popularity of this is because of the price reduction in the case of microprocessors, memory, as well as the secondary disk. So when the price become very smaller, if it is being reduced so that we can add more processors into the system so that we can increase the speed of the system, or we can effectively utilize the system in a better way. So that is one reason why the parallel machines are becoming popular. Then also in the meantime, the usage of databases are also growing in an increase in a very large way. So it is because of most of the applications we require more amount of transaction data, and they are to be collected, and that is to be stored for a better or later analysis. So huge amount of data transactions are being done for various applications, and we need to collect these data, and that is to be stored permanently. And nowadays we are using some special datas like multimedia objects like images and videos. They are also to be stored in database for various applications. Similarly, large scale parallel database systems are increasingly used for mainly for three purposes. One is for storing huge amount of data. Second one is in order to process the more time consuming decision support queries. So some of the queries that are used for getting some decisions based on the data present in the database. So we can reduce the processing time when we are applying some query on some larger databases. And similarly, we need to have a higher throughput so that more transactions can be executed within a given limited time. Now, how we can implement parallelism in databases? So as you know, data is the major part of any database. So when the volume of data increases, we need to have some parallelism so that we can execute, we can do more processing on the huge amount of data. Maybe the data is present in a different disk, or maybe present in a single disk also. So normally the data is partitioned across more number of disk when we are using a parallel IO system. That means when we want to apply parallelism on input or output operation, so input means we need to read the data from the disk. Similarly, output operation means we need to write the data into the disk. So these two operations we need to depend on this disk. So if it is being partitioned into different number of disk, if you have more number of disk, so this is the representation of disk. So if we add more number of disk into the system, we can store more amount of data, and the processing can also be distributed among these different disk. So accordingly, so if this is the situation, different queries can be run in parallel with each other, that is also called as inter-query parallelism. So we'll be discussing this in detail. So inter-query parallelism means two different or more than one queries can be executed simultaneously by referring to different disks that are present in the computer system. So there should be a concurrency control mechanism that should control the conflicts that may happen during the parallel execution by different queries accessing different disk, and sometimes they may be accessing some common data. So that situation we need to have the mechanism called as concurrency control. So normally the queries are entered into the system by using a standard language called as SQL. Then this SQL will be having a format. So as you know, SQL like select, delete, update, etc. So these statements are having some syntax. So when it is submitted to the system as part of an application program, it is to be translated into a relational algebra format. So it is an intermediate format of SQL statement, and by using this relational algebra it will do the internal processing like individual relational operations like sort operations, join and aggregation operations. So all these can be executed by using this relational algebra format of the SQL statement, and they can be executed in parallel. So sometimes the sorting can be executed in parallel, so different datas can be executed that is for sorting operation, or the same sort by using huge amount of data can be executed in parallel by using different disk that is already present in the system. And also we can partition the data into different disk, and each processor can work independently on its own partition. So if this disk is part of a process and if this disk is part of another process, so independently this process can utilize the data present in this particular disk and work on that particular data. So if it requires some data from some other disk, it need to go for some other parallelism mechanism so that it can access the data from other disk also. So it can execute locally as well as it can access the data that is present in some other disk also. So the databases normally lend themselves to parallelism by using these multiple number of disk added into the computer system, and it will increase the parallelism in the database processing. Now we will discuss in detail about IO parallelism. So what are the mechanisms that can be utilized for providing input and output operation parallelism with the support of databases? So IO parallelism will reduce the time required to retrieve the relations. The relations means the tables that are present in the disk. So a secondary disk always we are referring as the place where we are storing the database tables, which is usually referred as relations. And if we are having an IO parallelism that is being implemented, so we can reduce the time required for accessing these database tables that is present in the disk, and also by partitioning the tables into multiple number of disk. So we'll be having a partitioning mechanism so that we are not supposed to store the entire database table into a single disk. So we are dividing that table, so we are dividing that large table into different number of segments, and each of these segments are stored in different disk. So this segment will be stored in one disk, and this segment will be stored in this disk, and this one will be stored in this disk. So an entire table relation R can be divided into different number of partitions, and these partitions can be stored in different disk like disk 1, disk 2 and disk 3. So partitioning is the major mechanism that is used for providing an IO parallelism in the system. So we can do partitioning in two ways. That is one by using horizontal partitioning and second by using vertical partitioning. So horizontal partitioning is the major way of dividing the relations into multiple number of partitions, because we are storing the data in tuple format. So we'll be having number of tuples available, and most of the time we require the data in this tuple format, tuple or a row format. So most of the time we are doing horizontal partitioning. That means tuples of a relations are divided. So this is one set of tuples, this is second set of tuples, this is third set of tuples, and they are divided and each are stored in different disk. So assume that we are having the total number of disk is assigned as n. So if n number of disk are available, and if you are having a large database table like 100, a table with 100 tuples available, some tuples are assume that we are having 3 disk, that means n is equal to 3, number of disk is 3. And if you are having 100 tuples present in this particular table, so we will sometimes we will equally divide, or whatever be the way we are using, we will be dividing the tuples horizontally, and that will be stored in 3 different disk. So it is always better to maintain balance among all these disk, but that is not always possible, so we will see the issues later. So we will see the different types of horizontal partitioning mechanisms. We will see the basics of these partitioning now, and we will demonstrate that with diagrams in the next slide. So first category of partitioning is called as round robin partitioning. Round robin, as the name indicates, we are not giving any specific condition to the tuples. We are not applying any condition to the tuple. Simply, if we are having some disk available, if we are having some disk available, disk 1, disk 2, and disk 3, some tuples will go to this disk, some tuples will go this one, and some tuples will go this disk. So what is the way? So what we are following in round robin partitioning is, send the ith tuple in the relation to disk I mod n. So select any one I mod n. So I mod n will be getting, so I is the tuple number and n is the total number of disks. So here we are having 3 disks available. So if 6th tuple will go to 6th mod 3, that is 0, it will go to 0th disk. This is disk 0. So normally we are giving name like this, D0, D1 and D2. So 6 mod 3 will produce 0 as the value, and it will go to D0. Similarly, so as per, so 7th will go to 1st disk, 8th will go to 2nd disk. So if you are having 4 disk available, the tuple number modulus 4 into that particular disk, that particular tuple will be moved. So we can have some balancing. So randomly we are moving round robin. We are not giving any specific condition. We are not giving any condition on the values on that particular tuple. We are simply moving one particular tuple into one particular disk by simply applying the tuple number modulus n. N is equal to the total number of disks present in the system. That is one method. Now second one is called as hash partitioning. Hash partitioning means we need to choose one or more attributes from the table. So just a second. So this is the table. This is the table. We need to select one particular attribute, one or more, as the partitioning attribute. So this is called as partitioning attribute. This is called as partitioning attribute. So one will be selected as the partitioning attribute, and we need to apply. So we'll be having some values here. For example, this is roll number. For example, this is roll number attribute. Roll number attribute. roll number attribute will be having roll number 1, 2, 3, etc., etc. will be having the values available. So we need to apply a hash function h. So hash function is a function that is to be applied commonly to the attribute values present. So hash function, we are not clearly given which function we are using. It will be a function, whatever be the function that is to be given commonly for all the values present in this particular partition attribute. So apply hash function on all of these values present in the partition attribute, and this function should produce a value that ranges for. So the specialty of hash function is the value produced by applying the hash function h must be in the range between 0 to n minus 1, where n is the total number of disks available. So according to the hash function value, it will go to that corresponding disk. So again the same procedure. So previous case we are randomly moving the data, but here if the first row it is applying hash function to the roll number 1, it is getting a value. For example, it is getting a value 2. What will happen if it is getting a value 2? What will happen? It will go to 012. It will go to this particular disk. If it is getting a value 0, it will go to this particular disk. If it is getting a value 1, it will go to this particular disk. 0 to n minus 1. 0 to so if number of disk is 3, 0 to 2, 0, 1, 2. Among these three disks, the values will be distributed. So this is a different mechanism that is used for doing partitioning on the database table relations into different disk. Now let I denote result of hash function h applied to the partitioning attribute value of a tuple, send tuple to disk I. So if I denote the result, so if I is the result, the tuple must be moved to ith disk. That's all. If 0 is the result of hash function, it will move to 0th disk. Okay, so that is the procedure that is followed in hash partitioning mechanism. Now the third one is called as range partitioning. Range partition is a slightly different one. Range partition, so here also we are having different disk available. For example, we are having three disk available, and we are having a database table with some attributes and values, rows and columns. So we need to choose an attribute V as the partitioning attribute. So here also I will consider this as the partitioning attribute. So one attribute to be selected as the partitioning attribute. Now we need to find out a partitioning vector, that is PV. We need to find out a partitioning vector that is to be given like V0, V1 up to Vn minus 2, where n is the total number of disk. So here it is 3 disk available, so it should be, it must consist of n minus 2, that is 3 minus 2, that is 1. So V0, V1. So we should have two values, V0 and V1. The vector must consist of two values, V0 and V1. And how we can select these values? So that tuple such that Vi less than equal to V less than equal to Vi plus 1, it must go to disk I plus 1. So the value must be given like, it must be like, if it is roll number, I'll give a value like, for example, I'll give a value like 2, 5. So once again, I'll draw this. This is the table and this is the partitioning attribute, and we are having three disks available. Now we need to find out a partition vector V0 and V1. We should have two values here, the range boundary is decided by v0 up to vn minus 2. If you are having three disk available, vn 3 minus 2, that is 1, up to v0, v1, two values are required. So I am providing an example value here. So we can choose any value. So for example, I will be giving two values like 5 and 8. The vector values are 5 and 8. So the left value must be less than the right value, and right value must be a greatest value than the left value. That is a procedure that is to be followed by looking at these conditions. Now, if this tuple consists of a partitioned attribute value 1, it should go to the 0th disk. That is the procedure. So listen carefully. If it is 1, it should go to 0th disk. Okay, so it is very clear. So range partition, any value less than this v0 will go to the 0th disk. Any value between this v0 and v1 will go to first disk. And if any value greater than v0, v1 will go to the next disk. So that is called as range partitioning. So we are setting two values. If you are having more number of disks available, we will be having different ranges here. Now we are having only three disks, so we are having only two ranges. So two values in the partition vector. So two values means we will be having three ranges. One is less than v0, one is between v0 and v1, and third one is greater than v1. So this less than 5 value will go to disk 0, between 5 to 8 will go to 1, then greater than 8 will go to 2. That is called as range partitioning mechanism. So another example is given here, like 511, and we are having 3 disks, so similar format will be followed. I hope it is clear. So range partitioning. So once again, round robin means randomly one by one tuple will be moving into different disk based on I mod n. N is total number of disk. Hash partitioning means we need to select a particular attribute, and into that attribute apply a hash function. Will produce a value that ranges from 0 to n minus 1. Here also n is the total number of disk, and according to the value of that hash function, the tuple will move to the corresponding disk number. Now in the case of range partitioning, there also we need to select a particular attribute, partition attribute. Then we need to have a partition vector that ranges from 0 up v0 up to vn minus 2. N is the total number of disk. So for example, if you are having 3 disks available, so we should have v0 and v1. The vector must consist of 2 values and 3 ranges. So less than v0, the range will go to disk 0, v0 to v1 range will go to disk 1, and greater than v1 will go to disk 3. So these are the 3 types of horizontal partitioning that we are following for applying parallelism into the database systems. Now we'll have some comparison on these partitioning techniques. Now we will evaluate these partition techniques based on the different formats of data access. So normally we are using different types of queries. So we know to compare these different partition techniques, we are using 3 different categories of queries. So these types of queries are mainly followed in SQL statements and all. So first one is scanning the entire relation, like select star from student, scanning the entire relation. So we need to scan the entire relation from starting tuple till the last tuple. We need to scan on the entire relation table. These types of queries are called as scan queries. This is one category of queries where we need to scan the entire database table, the entire table to be scanned. Now the second, so this is mentioned here for comparing different partitioning techniques. Now second types of queries, they are locating a tuple associatively, that is called as point queries. Point queries means an example is given like from the relation the attribute a value is equal to 25, r dot a is equal to 25. For example, roll number is equal to 5. We are pointing. So select from table where roll number equal to 5. That type of queries are called as point queries. So scan queries, we need to select multiple tuples. Point queries, we need to select a particular tuple. A particular statement will be given with a particular value, that particular tuple to be retrieved. That is called as point queries. Now third one is locating all tuples such that the value of a given attribute lies between or specified within a range. That is called as range queries. Range queries means this relation attribute is between 10 and 25, mark between 50 and 70. So we'll be getting multiple tuples. So the selection of tuples based on some range where salary between 10,000 and 20,000, etc. So these types of queries are called as range queries. So there are three categories of queries: scan queries, scanning the entire relation; point queries, need to select only one particular tuple; and range queries will be selecting some portion of the entire relation. Not scanning the entire relation, need to access some portion, some range values only to be retrieved. That is called as range queries. So based on these three categories of queries, we will compare the various partition techniques which we were discussing in the previous slide. So first of all, round robin. So it is suited for sequential scan of the entire relation. So it is a better option for scan queries because what is the reason? Because all disks have almost an equal number of tuples. So as you see in our round robin mechanism, we can see from this diagram. So this will again explain how round robin will be applied. So this is the set of data available. From this data means this number of tuples, one tuple will go to P1, another tuple will go to P2, another tuple will go to Pn. Similarly, some other tuple will go to P1, then P2, Pn. Similarly, the tuples are almost equally posted or inserted into different disk. So here it is given P1 like the disk associated with each processor. That is why P1, P2 up to Pn is given. So sometimes each of these disks they are also referred to as a processor or disk, because we are discussing about database operations or database processing here. So sometimes disks are also referred as P in this particular topic. Now similarly, round robin, by using round robin partitioning, the retrieval work for the entire relation is well balanced between disks because of this equal distribution of tuples into different number of disks. So if you are having three disks available, almost equal number of tuples will be available on all of these disks. So the retrieval will be like from all the partitions, from all the disks we can equally access the data while applying an SQL query for accessing the entire relation table. Now for this round robin partitioning, the point queries and range queries are difficult to process because there is no grouping, there is no clustering is happening. So P1 is not having any specific category of tuples available, or P2 is not having any specific category of tuples available, or Pn, any processor, any disk does not consist of any particular category of tuples. The tuples are simply distributed without having any constraint. So in order to find out a particular tuple from any of this disk will be very difficult. So point queries as well as range queries, also a group of just like a salary between two values, etc. All these are very difficult because that range will be related to some set of tuples only. So here all the tuples are distributed. So it will be a difficult task when we are using point queries or range queries in the case of round robin partitioning. So round robin is well suited for sequential scan. It is for scan queries. Now the second one, hash partitioning. So again, it is also good for sequential access or scan queries. So just look at this diagram, how this hash partitioning is happening. This is the entire database table. Tuples are available. With each tuple, by selecting a partition attribute, it will be applying a hash function h. According to the hash function, some tuple will go to p1, some tuple go to p2, then pn. Similarly, all the tuples will be moving into different processes, different disk, based on the hash function value. Now if the hash function is a good function, so that we can equally distribute, and the partitioning attribute is a key, so there are two conditions. If the hash function is good, because we can choose the hash function, if it is a good hash function, so that we'll get proper values on each of the data. And also, if the partitioning attribute is a key attribute, we can equally distribute the tuples into different number of disk. If the hash function is good, as well as if the key is primary key, that is an example. If it is not primary key, what will happen? There will be more number of tuples moving into one particular disk depending on the hash function. For example, roll number, if that attribute is a primary key, we are having roll number 2, and if you are applying a hash function to 2, every time it will be getting the same value. So every time all those rows will be moving into one particular disk, so more tuples will be here when compared to the second disk. So we will not be equally distributing the tuples into different disk. So if the hash function is good, as well as if it is a primary key or key attribute, we can equally distribute. Now the trivial work for entire relation is well balanced. If this is the situation, if we are retrieving the entire relation by using a sequential or scan queries, we can easily access the data from this number of disk. So round robin is suited for sequential scan queries at any point of time, but hash partitioning, the scan query is applicable only when if the hash function is a good one and the partitioning attribute is any key. Now it is so it is good for scan queries. Now it is good for point queries on partitioning attribute. Now the second comparison, whether it is good for point queries or not. So it is good for point queries because what is point query? A particular tuple to be retrieved. Now if partition attribute is a good attribute, now as I was mentioning here, if the partitioning attribute is a key attribute, and if you are selecting, if you are applying a query on this partition at where roll number equal to 10, it will automatically go to one particular disk with the hash function. So here what will be happening is we need to apply the same hash function into that particular query also, so that it will find the hash function and find out the corresponding disk where that particular tuple resides. So it is good for point queries when the partition attribute is a key. So it need to look into a single disk only, don't need to go to some other disk, leaving others available for answering other queries. So these tuples, these disk will be free for accepting any queries that are submitted by some other user. Now index on partitioning attribute can be local to disk, so making lookup and update more efficient. So if you are having an index being created on this attribute, even it will be better for accessing or pointing into a particular. So you know, index in database, if you already add an index into a particular table, into a particular attribute, the access will be little more easier when we compare with the normal access without having an index. So just like we are having an index page in a textbook, we can easily go into a particular chapter. So here also, if we create an index on a particular attribute, we can easily search or find out the particular tuple present in a particular disk. So it is good for scan queries and it is good for point queries. But here also there is no grouping happens, so it is difficult to answer range queries. So there is no grouping. So according to the hash function, it is simply moving into different disk. But it is not focusing on a range or common constraint. Simply looking into the hash function value, it is moving into different disk. So it is not a good mechanism for the purpose of accessing data using range queries. Now, third one, range partitioning. It provides data clustering that was not there with round robin and the previous, that is hash partitioning. So here we are having a data grouping. So as you know, ranges, so 5 and 8, this is the partition vector. So we are having one range here, another range here, and another range here. So data is being grouped, so all the values are grouped below 5 here, all the values between 5 and 8 is grouped here, and all the values greater than 8 is grouped here. So it is good for sequential access. So sequential access is also easier. It is also good for point queries, because according to the value, it need to look into that particular disk only. That is, in which range that particular data or tuple may reside. Accordingly, we can move into that particular disk alone. So look at this diagram. So this is the given data. So A to G, one range is stored in P1, another range is stored in P2, some other range is stored in PN. So sequential access is also easier. By passing through P1, P2 up to PN, it is possible. Point queries, sometimes if you want to get I data, we need to refer to only this particular disk. If you want to have some data between U and Z, need to refer to only PN. So point queries are also easier. So because we need to have the access to only one disk at a time. And now for range queries on partitioning attribute, one to a few disk may need to be accessed. So if salary less than 5000, sometimes we need to refer to only P1, or sometimes if the range comes here also, we need to refer to P1 and P2 alone, leaving other processes or disk free. So as it is having grouping or clustering, we can refer to either one disk or more than one disk for getting a particular range query values. So the remaining disks are available for other queries. It is good if result tuples are from one to a few blocks. If many blocks are to be fetched and they are still fetched from one to a few disks, the potential parallelism in disk access is wasted. Now, if many blocks are to be fetched and they are still fetched from one to a few disks, so the problem with this range partitioning is the problem called as execution skew. It's because sometimes less than 5, by looking at this, less than 5, P1 will be having only some 5 tuples. Between 5 to 8, sometimes will be having some 50 tuples available. And greater than 8 will be having some 150 tuples available, maybe, that we cannot assure. So even if you are having grouping, we can see that there is an imbalance between different disks. So P1 consists of only 5 tuples, P2 consists of 50 tuples, and PN consists of 150 tuples. So there is an imbalance between disks. That is actually called as execution skew. So average execution time depends on the average number of tuples available within this particular disk. So if the query is expecting the values from only P1, we can easily retrieve that. If it is expecting the values from P1 and P2, when compared to P1, it will take more time, because here 50 tuples are there. Now if the range is between P2 and PN, 50 plus 150, so we need to iterate through this much number of values present in these two disks. So execution skew may happen. So in this particular situation, if skew is the situation, it will be always better to use either round robin or hash partitioning mechanism for accessing such type of data when we are having some execution skew happens between the ranges of values present in the disk. Now how we can handle the skew problem? So if there is an imbalance between the number of tuples present in the disk. Now partitioning a relation across disk. So first of all, if a relation contains only few tuples which will fit into a single disk, then it is always better to assign into that single disk. So if the so we are looking into different situations. If a relation contains only few number of tuples, just assign that into only a single disk. It is always better. Don't go for partitioning. Now if large relations are partitioned, so normally large relations are partitioned across all the available disk. Now if a relation consists of m disk blocks and if there are n number of disk available, then the relation should be allocated to minimum of mn disk. For example, if a relation consists of m disk blocks, for example if a relation consists of 6 disk blocks and if the number of disk available is 3, now the relation should be allocated to only 3 disk. 6 disk blocks are available, the relation consists of 6 disk blocks, but we are having only 3 disk available, minimum of these 2 is 3, so it must be allocated into 3 number of disk only. So the distribution of tuples to disk may be skewed. So by using any of the previous methods, like especially for range partitioning, the distribution of tuples may lead to the problem called as skew. So some disks have many tuples while others may have few number of tuples only. So first of all, let us see what are the different types of skew. First skew, that is called as attribute value skew. All the tuples with the same value for the partitioning attribute end up in the same partition. So by using the previous method, if the tuple with the same value for the partitioning attribute will always go to the same partition. That is called as attribute value skew. So if the skew is being created depending on the value of the attribute, it is called as attribute value skew. It can occur with range partitioning as well as hash partitioning. Range partitioning, if we are having the value 3, so all the 3 will be moving into the same range. Hash partition also, if the value is 3, it will produce the same hash function value, it will go to the same partition only. So attribute value skew. Now next one is called as partition skew. What is partition skew? It is normally happening with range partitioning. So with range partitioning, badly chosen partition vector, so if the vector is not properly chosen, like if you are having 3 ranges available, if these 3 ranges are not properly taken, if we select random values, sometimes some range may have more number of tuples, so it may produce a partition skew. So it is less likely with hash partitioning if a good hash function is chosen. It is not always possible to have a partition skew when we are using a hash partitioning mechanism, but with range partitioning it is always having a chance of partition skew, because we may choose a bad partition vector to decide the range of tuples to be stored in the different partition disk. Now how we can handle the skew in range partitioning? So that means we were mentioning in the previous slide about partition vector is chosen in a bad way. So how we can resolve that? So for that we need to create a balanced partition vector, so that we can almost equally assign the tuples into different partition disk. So here we are assuming partitioning by attributes, we are creating a balanced partition vector by assuming partitioning attribute forms a key of the relation. So first of all, we are assuming that the partition attribute is a key. What we are doing is, first of all, just sort the relation on the partition attribute. Whichever attribute is selected as the partition attribute, just do a sorting. Then from the sorted partition attribute, construct the partition vector by scanning the relation in sorted order as follows.
After every 1 by nth of the relation has been read, take the next tuple as the partition vector. So just see example here. Assume that the number of disk is 3, n is equal to 3, and this is a sorted partition attribute. The attribute is being sorted. So one, so if you are having 3, take any every 1 by third tuple, take the next tuple, so 1 by third. So if it is equally divided, we can easily find out the range. After sorting equally, take 1 by third next tuple as the partition vector. So here 1 to 4, so this, so 7 is selected as the so 1 by third, this one, next tuple 7, this is selected as the partition vector. First value here 1 to 4, that is 7. 7 means less than 7. Now 7 to 11, so 12 will be selected here, 12 will be selected here, then here 16 will be selected. So the partition vector forming here is 7, 12 and 16. So that the values present in this particular tuple or relation will be almost equally ranged between less than 7, 7 to 12, 12 to 16 and greater than 16. So that is a mechanism that can be used for reducing skew, and the method is called as creation of balanced partition vector. Now how we can handle this skew by using, by how it will be implemented inside the system, it is by using or maintaining a histogram. So the balanced partition vector can be constructed by forming a histogram. So the system will be having the range of values like this one. So this is an example histogram, its range value and the frequency, the number of times that range of values that are present. So a frequency histogram, frequency value histogram graph will be maintained in the system so that we can balance we can look into the available number of tuples between different range of values. So assume uniform distribution within each range of the histogram. So histogram can be constructed by scanning the relation, or we can do some sampling the tuples in the relation, and histogram can be stored in the system catalog. So by looking into the system catalog, we can find out whether the partition vector or the vector is being balanced or not. So this is a supporting mechanism that is used for forming a balanced partition vector by looking into the histogram that is already stored in the database system catalog. By looking into the histogram, we can see whether it is balanced, or if it is not balanced, we can apply the sorting or any other mechanism for balancing the values, tuples present in the database relation. Now another mechanism for handling the skew is by using a virtual processor partitioning. So different disks are having different number of tuples, imbalance between disk, that is our problem. So here we are using a mechanism called as virtual processor partitioning. So what we are doing is creates a large number of partitions, say 100. What we are doing is the relation will be divided into a large number of partitions. So normally we are dividing into 2 or 3 numbers, that is for the real number of disk available. But here by using virtual processor partitioning, we are dividing the relation into huge large number of partitions, like 10 to 20 times than the number of processes available. And with each of these partitions, we will assign virtual processes, and it will be assigned to each of these virtual processes. So each of these small ranges will be assigned to each of these virtual. So we'll be having more number of virtual processes available, and it will be assigned based on round robin fashion. Partition will be done either by using round robin or it is based on the cost of processing. So any of this mechanism we can partition the relation into the different virtual processes. Then after that, so that is the basic mechanism of dividing or partitioning the relation into different more number of virtual processes. That is the basic thing. So if any normal partition would have been skewed, it is very likely the skew is spread over a number of virtual partitions. So if we are doing more number of partitions, there is less chance of having skew. Then the skewed virtual partitions get spread. When we are applying more number of virtual processes, it will be spread across more number of processes. So work will be distributed evenly. So that is a procedure. So we'll give the explanation based on the given diagram. So what we are doing is, this is the given data. We are having a large relation available, and some ranges are, will be having some more number of virtual processes available here. So some range will move to virtual processor 1, some other range will move to virtual processor 2, then VP3, VP4, VP5. We will be having more virtual processes available, maybe by using round robin partitioning mechanism. Then after that, from these virtual processes, it will further apply the partitioning and divide the contents into different real processes. Then there will be almost, we can assume that we'll be, this data will be distributed almost uniformly. So applying the partitioning on the virtual process and the data is present in this virtual process, again moving into the real processes, again doing further round robin partitioning, will move some of the tuple from virtual processor 1 into P1, then some of the virtual processor tuple into P2, then P3. So almost finally this data will be distributed among these three processes almost in a uniform manner, so that we can avoid, so if we directly have only three processes and this is being distributed, maybe some will be having more number of tuples and some will be having only less number of tuples. But if it is moved to many number of virtual processes and further it is being partitioned among these different real processes, so these are the real disk or processes available, it will be almost equally being balanced among different processes. So that is all about IO parallelism. So this session we were discussing about the introduction to parallel databases, then the various IO parallelism, introduction to IO parallelism, then various partitioning mechanism, partitioning techniques like round robin, hash partitioning and range partitioning mechanism, the usages, the comparison on different situations when we are using scan queries, range queries and point queries, and we have seen the comparison between these three partitioning mechanism, and also we have seen the issue of skew, creation of skew due to the imbalancing of different processes or disk present in the system, and skew will may be a problem in situations, so we need to have some solution for reducing the skew. So we have seen some mechanism for reducing the skew during the partitioning process also. So that's it for now. We will see the other mechanisms for parallel databases. Other types of parallelism will be discussed in the next video. Thank you.